election, there was talk of a post-racial America. And such a vision, however well-intended, was never realistic. Race remains a potent and often divisive force in our society. Now, I've lived long enough to know that race relations are better than they were 10 or 20 or 30 years ago, no matter what some folks say. You can see it not just in statistics, you see it in the attitudes of young Americans across the political spectrum. But we're not where we need to be. And all of us have more work to do. If every economic issue is framed as a struggle between a hardworking white middle class and an undeserving minority, then workers of all shades are going to be left fighting for scraps while the wealthy withdraw further into their private enclaves. If we're unwilling to invest in the children of immigrants just because they don't look like us, we will diminish the prospects of our own children, because those brown kids will represent a larger and larger share of America's workforce. And we have shown that our economy doesn't have to be a zero-sum game. Last year, incomes rose for all races, all age groups, for men and for women. So if we're going to be serious about race going forward, we need to uphold laws against discrimination in hiring and in housing and in education and in the criminal justice system.
Black human packages tied up in strings. Black rage can come from all these kinds of things. Black rage is founded on blatant denial, discrete economics, subsistence survival, deafening silence, and social control. Black rage is founded on wounds in the soul. When the dogs bite, when the bees sting, when I'm feeling sad, I simply remember all these kinds of things, and then I don't fear so bad.
According to Business Insider, a former Facebook employee claims that Facebook has a black people problem. Former strategic partner manager Mark Lucky sent a 2,500-word memo to his coworkers detailing his experiences of racism at the company and what he says are the company's failures to build a more inclusive workplace that is supportive of people of color. Lucky claims that black employees were routinely marginalized and recounted stories of being aggressively accosted by campus security beyond what was necessary. Lucky said that teams needed to hire more diverse workers and that underrepresented groups are being systematically excluded from communication. Lucky's criticisms opens up a crisis on a new front for Facebook, which is already reeling from multiple scandals. Facebook spokesperson Anthony Harrison said the company has been working diligently to increase the range of perspectives, adding that the growth in representation of people from more diverse groups working in many different functions across the company is a key driver of our ability to succeed.
The only black male anchor on Fox News is speaking out about alleged racial discrimination at the cable channel. Kelly Wright's claims are part of a class action lawsuit filed this week against Fox News. At least 11 current and former employees accuse executives of fostering a, quote, culture of severe racial harassment. The suit says Fox ignored their complaints for years.
Now, Fox News denies the claims and says, quote, we will vigorously defend these cases. An emotional Wright yesterday explained his decision to join the suit.
I want to make it possible for whoever fills my shoes, that next generation, to never go through this.
This is America. Don't catch you slipping now. Don't catch you slipping now. Look what I'm whipping now. This is America. Don't catch you slipping now. Don't catch you slipping now. Look what I'm whipping now. This is America. Don't catch you slipping now. Look how I'm living now. Police be tripping now. Yeah, this is America.
A study where they sent out job applications, bogus job applications, using a sort of typically white name such as Emily Smith, mm-hmm. and the exact same application or similar qualifications with a name such as Lakeisha Washington, or, you know, and they got a far greater response to the Emily Smith types of names.
Yeah, Harvard sent out 5,000 applications. 2,500 had traditionally white names, 2,500 had traditionally African-American names. And of these 5,000 applications that they submitted to about 1,000 jobs, both the white and African-American pool had equal resumes. So mm-hmm. on paper, these should have gotten the same amount of feedback. And they did again find that one in every 10 resumes from a white applicant was accepted. One in every 15 resumes from an African-American applicant was accepted. So that's a 50% disparity.
And something else that was shocking was that if a white applicant had a higher educational background, there was a very good chance that they would get a job. If a black applicant had a higher educational background, there was no difference. There was no change.
Yeah, there was absolutely no change, and they actually found that for an African-American applicant to be on the same footing as a white applicant, you have to have 8 additional years of job experience, even when all other things were equal. Mm-hmm. So this report was really, really disturbing.
Why is this the case? After all this time, what is behind all of this?
Well, UC Berkeley recently commissioned a study where they tried to dig a little deeper and say, why would this be happening? Mm-hmm. And they specifically focused on who were the hiring managers and did the race of the hiring manager have anything to do here? So what they did was a 30-month study where they looked at a major U.S. corporation. They looked at 100,000 hiring managers, and they found that hiring managers who were white, Asian, or Latino disproportionately hired white applicants and disproportionately did not hire African-American applicants. It was only when hiring managers were African-American themselves that the pool wound up being closer to national averages.
Very interesting. So I guess the answer there is make sure that more African-Americans make it to the managerial position and actually
it's
end up
difficult.
Hiring.
I mean, the UC Berkeley study tried to distinguish why would this be happening, and they came up with 3 potential causes. Mm-hmm. One is that you tend to have your own networks that you hire from, and that if you were a white, Asian, or Latino hiring manager, you may not have as many trusted African-Americans in your own network. One is that managers may feel that they're going to get more out of an employee that's more like them, so they tend to hire more along racial lines. Or the third is just out-and-out discrimination, that people are not taking people for face value.
How much does your name matter when you're applying for a job?
We've all seen the news reports and peer-reviewed articles showing what a supposed black or brown-sounding name might do to your chances of getting hired. But a new meta-analysis has taken an inventory of these hiring discrimination studies going back a quarter century, only to find, statistically speaking, very little has changed for black applicants. The study looked at every available field experiment of hiring discrimination against African Americans or Latinos since 1989. In total, that's nearly 56,000 applications for over 26,000 jobs. After tallying the data, the researchers concluded whites receive, on average, 36% more callbacks than African Americans and 24% more callbacks than Latinos, with no observable level of change for black applicants from 1989 to 2015. The results of these hiring discrimination studies seem to parallel other statistical gaps in black family wealth and income. In 1967, the difference in median household income for a black family versus a white family was $20,000. By 2014, that gap had widened to $28,000. A similar gap persists for college-educated black and white households. And while black folks are still more than twice as likely as whites to live in poverty, that gap has narrowed since 1980. The author of the hiring discrimination study says, despite a liberalization of attitudes over the years, this more subtle racial bias persists and underscores the need for compensatory policies. Discrimination continues, and we find little evidence in regards to African Americans that it is disappearing or even gradually diminishing.